everyone, Carol here at Oak House Journals, and I thought I would show you today how I make these little accordion map books. Really easy to do and quite pretty, depending on what papers you use for the covers. As you can see, I've just got an acetate band round mine, and this is what happens when you take the acetate band off. So it will open out into an accordion fold book. Now, as you can see, I have just used old map paper inside here, and for my outside cover I have used wrapping paper and a bit of embroidery thread to tie it up. But these are really fascinating things to play with. You can position them as you want on your desk if you want them like so. You can close them up and have them like that. You could have a band round the outside to hold it closed that way if you wanted to. I actually made this one a while ago to fit into one of the compartments in my printer's tray, and that's what dictated the size. But you can make these any size that you want to, and I'll show you how. So as I say, you can position them any way you want. You can put both ends down and have them sitting as a dome on your desk. So if I turn that sideways, you can see what it looks like. So you can have them sitting like so on your desk. Or the other thing you can do with them is if you get a paper clip and clip the start of the book to the back of the book along one of the edges, and I'm just going to choose an inside edge here, you can have it sat on your desk like so, or you can just push it over and it will sit like that. Or you can have it the other way. You see, they've got a mind of their own. Or you can have it that way round. Whoops-a-daisy, doesn't want to go. You could have it that way round, so all the book pages are showing, and it really does look quite pretty on your desk. But as you can see, they have a mind of its own. The reason it wants to pop up when I've got the book page this way up is because that paper clip is at the bottom, so it's pushing it up. Now, if I clipped it on this side, then it wouldn't pop up. As you can see, when I do it that way, it's happier to sit. So it just depends where you position that paper clip. As I say, it's on the inside here, but if I clipped it on this edge and flipped it that way, it would sit quite happily. But these remind me a bit of the children's toy called a slinky that we used to have years ago that you could throw downstairs. It was a metal spiral, and you could throw it downstairs and it would walk down steps and things. And you can actually do that with this. You could have it so that it is resting on a shelf and then draping over onto another shelf, or you can just make it for the pure joy of making it, which is exactly what I did with mine. So I'm going to show you how I made mine. And again, as I say, really easy, and you can vary the sizes. So for the cover, you want to use paper that is fairly thin. So you're not using cardstock or designer paper. I would say if you work with something the weight of printer paper, nothing heavier than round about 90 GSM. What is absolutely ideal for getting the length that you want and also the paper weight is if you work with wrapping paper. This is my cover, and I've made this out of just normal bog standard wrapping paper that I have bought from a card shop or a gift shop. This paper is recycled craft paper, and that, if I hold it like so and run it through my fingers, you can see that it is a long length. Now, that is actually a width of some standard roll of wrapping paper here in the UK. But what you want to do is you want to get a strip of paper that is about, it doesn't have to be exact, about 28 inches long. So if you get a roll of wrapping paper that is only 26 inches, it doesn't matter. But you don't really want to be making this with A4 sheets of printer paper. That your little book is not going to be very big at all. I would say it's probably only going to end up being kind of that size, which isn't going to give you the effect or the meanderability, if you will, of your book. So you're looking for around 28 inches long, which works out at 71 centimetres. And in terms of width, as I said, you can make yours any size that you want. I made mine the height to fit my printer's tray. So this is, in terms of height, it's 1.5 inches in height or 4 centimetres. And the width of my cover, this bit here, is just over 1/2 inch. So it is exactly 1.5 centimetres, which works out at just over 1/2 inch. So what I did was I cut a strip of wrapping paper. Now, because this is fairly thin wrapping paper, I cut mine double the width. And if you're working to the same dimensions as me and have one of these Tim Holtz ideology rulers, you will find that the width is exactly 4 centimetres, which is absolutely perfect. So what I did was I cut a strip of my wrapping paper that was double the width, plus a little bit extra so I could trim it and get a neat edge. So I just got a glue book and just a normal glue stick. So as you can see, I'm just working my way along my piece of paper here. With my glue stick. Okay, so we're all glued here. And all I'm doing is folding it over and making sure it is all glued together really well. So once you've glued your strip together, what I like to do is just go along it with a bone folder just to reinforce the crease that you have and to make sure everything is adhered nicely. So I've gone along my length, and now what I do is I just need to trim off that excess. Now, if you have one of these Tim Holtz ideology rulers, one of the edges, the squared off edge, has a metal strip in it. So again, it's ideal for doing this. But if not, you could use a normal metal ruler. And all I'm going to do is trim off the excess with a craft knife. We've glued our strip and we're ready now to create the folds or the creases to make the accordion fold for the cover. So the best tip that I can give you is to make sure that the end that you start with is a straight edge, that it's cut at 90 degrees, and that will help you keep everything in alignment. So this is just a demonstration piece that I've got here, so I'm not bothered that I have this white edge down the bottom. But what I tend to do is I tend to make sure that it is perfectly aligned in my scoreboard, and I put a little bit of gentle pressure on this corner here where I'm going to start my scoring. Now, as I mentioned to you, the width of the cover is 1.5 centimetres, which earlier I said was roughly about just over 1/2 inch. Well, it's actually 5/8 of an inch. So I'm using the marker here on my inch board, and I've got the 5/8 marker, and I'm just going to score a line with my tool. Now, the options that you have here are that you could go along and you could score all the way along your piece and then accordion fold it backwards and forwards at the end. That's one way of doing it. I prefer to do it another way. I prefer to score and fold as I go. And the reason I do that is that I can make sure that each fold and each crease that I make is perfectly aligned. So to make the other folds, the way I do it is I will take my piece of paper and the fold that I've just made here and burnished with my fingers, I will put that in to the start here of my scoreboard, and I'm actually applying a little bit of pressure to push it into that corner so that I've actually got a very good fold in that corner. And then I'm just going along to my marking point, my 5/8, and making my second mark or my second crease. So as you can see, it's there. Now this time I'm folding it up to create a mountain fold. Now for those of you that are not familiar with valley and mountain folds, this is a valley fold and this is a mountain fold. So you've got a valley here and this is your mountain. So I'm creating a mountain fold here and I'm aligning my crease with this edge and burnishing it so that I get really good alignment along here, along the top and along the bottom. And as you work your way along, that becomes more and more important. Now to carry on doing this, all I do is flip it over so that I've got that 90 degree angle here and I put that in the corner of my scoreboard or the start of my scoreboard and I go in, sorry I'm using the wrong end there, I go in and create another crease. And by doing it this way, this one is also a mountain fold, which I'm burnishing. And by doing it this way, you automatically create your accordion fold. You don't have to think about whether you're folding it backwards and forwards. Every time when you do a fold, you're creating a mountain fold or you're doing a mountain fold. So I've done this one here. It's all lined up with this edge. I just flip it over to get that 90 degree angle there, pop it back into the corner, get the right end of my tool and create another one. And yes, it is a bit of a faff doing a fold every time you go, burnishing that crease every time you go rather, but it makes sure that you get a really neat finish on your little book at the end, because you're making sure that everything sits nicely in alignment. Okay, so now I'm going to make the signatures for inside the cover, and I've got some pieces of old matte paper here. This is just a well-worn map that I've torn up into strips along the folds of the map to make it easier for me to work with. Now, as I said to you, the width of the cover is exactly the width of a Tim Holtz ruler. So, to make life easy for myself, all I did was cut out strips of the map paper using my Tim Holtz ruler and my knife. So my strips of paper will be, or my strips of matte paper will be 4 centimeters across. So literally all I did was cut out lots and lots of strips of matte paper, and now all I'm doing is trimming them down to 4.5 millimeters, 4.5 centimeters. And I tend to put, you could do this with a craft knife. I tend to do it on my guillotine because I know then I'm getting a straight edge up here against this bar. What I tend to do for ease is I just put a little post-it note or a sticky just in front of the marker so that I don't even have to register particularly where it's going. I know that if I go to the marker in front of my post-it note that I'm in the right place. That means I can watch videos and all sorts as I'm doing this, because you need a good few of these. And I don't even mind when I get to the end of my map paper like this, or where the index is or the key is on the map. I don't mind. I think they all add interest. You don't have to use matte paper. You could use old book paper or tea stained paper, coffee stained paper. Ideally, it would be great if you had double-sided paper, but the old vintage maps that I have here are all single-sided. But I do know that if you use street maps, you know, you can get A to Z street maps of towns and whatever. They're obviously going to be double-sided and they would work well. I'm kind of working on the premise that if these are single-sided, then you have somewhere to write. So now all I do is fold them in half so that they are folded along their longer length, so along the 4.5 centimeter length. So I fold them in half, and again, another Zen thing that you can do whilst you're watching the television in the evening. So I fold three in half and then I just slot them inside each other. Now it's a good time to actually orientate your papers now, because if you do, that saves you a job later on. But as I say, all I'm doing now is just folding them up in half like so, very, very easy. And for each signature, I just put three of these together. So three just tucked inside each other, like so. Make sure your crease is good. And then that's all ready to go, more or less. So you don't actually have to have three sheets of matte paper or whatever paper you choose. You could actually decide to go with just two. I would suggest you didn't go for one, because it's not really going to give much substance to your little book. But two is not going to make much difference. I prefer three. If you're going to go with more than three, I would think that you might end up having a bit of a problem, for the simple reason that you're just doing a very simple fold on your cover paper. And if you're putting more than three of these together, you're going to start building up a little bit of bulk at your creased edge here, which might knock your folding off when you come to put these inside the cover. So I would just work with two or three. All right, so on to the next stage. Okay, so we have our strips of paper folded into a long accordion, and what you want to do is you want to make sure that the ends are facing in the right direction. So if you can see on this one, this is one of my ends and I have a fold line here. So if I just turn it over, I've got the same on this side. So this is my end of my accordion, and if I just pull it up slightly, you can see I have a fold there. Now, what we're going to do is we are going to insert our papers into each one of these little valleys. Okay. So you want to make sure that you have the orientation right when you do this. So what I tend to do is lie it out flat on my mat and work from this end back towards this end. You could do it the other way round, but just be consistent so that it's you don't miss putting your papers in the right valley fold. Okay, so that's our accordion. That's ready to go. And as you can see, I've started doing one here. If I pull it down. So what you have next are you have all your papers. Now here are my papers. I've just put one of my famous little hair bands around it, and all I've done is I've cut these all to size and I've put them in groups of three. You could put in two pages per valley if you wish. I like to use three. The next thing you need to do is just take your papers and make sure that the orientation is going to be the right way round for you. So I just tend to check mine before I do each one and reinforce the fold. So here's another piece. Now that's round the right way. And I've only lifted out two pieces, so I need to just grab myself a third piece. And all I'm doing is I'm slotting each piece of paper inside the next one to create a mini signature. Then what I tend to do is I just tap it down on my work surface so that I've got a level edge here. Now the top should be level for you, but as what always happens with paper, folded paper, when you insert one sheet inside another, the inside sheets, if they're all the same size, the inside sheets stick out slightly. So can you just see? I have a couple of little edges there. Now, what I tend to do, as I say, is tap so that my bottom edge is level. And then I just minusculely take a smidgen off the top. Now, if you remember, you cut these to exactly the same size as your cover. So that's fine if you want them to be exactly the same size as your cover. But what I tend to do is just take an absolute slither off the top there and I level up the edges here. Now, you could leave them like this if you wished. That's absolutely up to you. All I do is, and I'm going to just lift this to one side, I just bring in my guillotine. You could do this with a craft knife if you prefer. And I literally am taking the barest smidgen off the top. Hanging on, keeping the pressure tight here so that this doesn't move. And I'm just levelling that up. And again, you can see just the tiniest of slithers are coming off there. And I do that with each one as I go. The next thing you want to do, let me just lift this back in. I like to work on a rubber mat. This is because I'm using a piercing tool, but it also gives me somewhere where I can anchor my needle. So I have my signature here and I have a template here. Now this is just a piece of card that is as wide as my cover. And all I've done is I've made a couple of holes in it where, just two holes, where I'm going to be stitching through. Now that is my template for stitching. Now it is useful if you have it exactly the same size as each signature and also longer, and you'll see why in a moment. So all I've done is I've put my template, folded piece of card, in the centre of my signature and I'm pushing towards this crease edge here just to make sure we have good contact. Then I'm going to make sure that the orientation is right before I put it in my first fold. Now here's my valley fold here, so I'm just going to put it in and I'm going to pinch it with my thumb and middle finger at the back so that it is held in place. And the good thing is, by having that template and the signature, you can just feel with your fingers that it is flush with your cover. So I'm pinching that, I hope you can see that, I'm pinching it between my thumb and middle finger. You can use whichever fingers you want, but I find those work for me. And then I'm just feeling with these fingers here, just feeling that it is flush in the cover. Now if it isn't and you need to trim it some more, that's fine, but you will feel it. Okay, and if it is flush, it'll give you a nicer finish. Okay, so still keeping that pinch so that your papers are in place, what I tend to do then is get a paper clip and just push it between your template and clip the front side of it with the paper clip. Okay. I then take another paper clip and I clip the back. Okay, and you'll see better in just one moment. And then if I open that up, you could see that my signature is held securely in place inside my cover and it's not going to go anywhere. And the good thing about having this template longer is that you can actually just check that it is lined up with the rest of the cover. Okay, so now what I do, we have our two holes in here. I just line up my pokey tool. You could use a needle, a sharp needle, or whatever pokey tool you have. And I just line that up with the mark inside. I close up my fold just a little bit and just poke my tool down. Now I'm not pushing it far, I'm just doing the other hole. And by closing up your fold a little bit, it makes sure that you get your holes perfectly aligned along the bottom of your valley fold, which is what you want for a nice neat finish. Okay, so we've done that. Now what I tend to do is I just take away the front paper clip, fold back the template and put the paper clip back in place. Now I have a needle threaded up here with some thread. You could use wax thread if you want to. This is just Perlay cotton. This is a 12 weight Perlay cotton. I've doubled this up because I think this works better. It looks better. A single thread is absolutely fine. Will do the job because this is not going to take a lot of stress and weight. But I actually think using two threads looks better for the finish. As I say, you could use a fine wax thread if you want to. You could even use crochet cotton if you want to. Any of those would be absolutely fine. So as I say, I've threaded up a needle and all I am doing now is I'm going from the front of the cover or the reverse of the cover, coming up into the centre of the signature. I'm just catching, I'm leaving a tail of about 3 to 4 inches, probably about 3 is about the best, and I'm just catching that at the back to hold it, and then I'm going down from the centre of the signature again out to the cover. Okay, and again I'm catching that round a finger and I'm just holding it there. So those are the threads coming through. Now I'm taking away the other, the template away from the other paper clip. So all the time your signature has been held in place by the two paper clips. Now I'm still leaving those paper clips in place and I'm flipping it over, still hanging on to those two threads, snipping it off so that we have roughly a 3-inch tail on either side. There we go, if I hold that out like so. And then all I'm doing now is a loose knot. Now you can do this a tight knot if you want to now, trying to get your knot centered along the crease of your valley fold. So you could try and do a tight knot now. I don't, for the simple reason that I need a third hand. So what I tend to do is tighten them all up afterwards. But what I do is just make a loose knot now. You don't need it to be very tight at all, just a loose knot like so. Then I flip it over again, still leaving this front paper clip in place because we're working in that direction. Still leave it in place. I take away the back one, fold over my signature, take out the front paperclip, and I'm holding it here with my thumb, and I'm putting it back so that the whole of the signature is trapped now. And then it leaves me free to move on to my next valley fold. So this is the one we've just done, and this is the next one that we're going to do. And I just repeat that process. But because I've left these knots fairly loose, I want to make sure that my signatures are held in place with the paper clip. And by folding them this way, the direction that you're working, it makes sure that they stay out of the way when you try to do your next signature or sew in your next signature. Okay. When you've gone all the way along your piece, it's going to look something like this with all these threads and loose knots, and everything on this side is going to be pegged in place with your paper clips. Now, to actually tighten up the knots, it's the same process for tightening up the knots regardless of whether you leave them all loose until the end and tighten them up at the end, or if you tighten them up as you go along. Now, having made several of these, I've actually changed my mind. The earlier ones, I was leaving my knots loose and tightening up, or leaving my threads loose and tightening up the knots at the very end. But what I soon discovered halfway through was that I actually like tightening my knots as I go. And that's what it looks like on this side. And as you can see, I've tightened them and snipped them as I've gone. But the process for actually doing the knots is exactly the same, regardless of whether you leave them all to do at the end or decide to do them along the way. And as you can see, this is where I've used the just plain embroidery thread doubled up. And this is where I've started using crochet cotton. So this is my crochet cotton, and this is a Mercer crochet cotton. It's a cotton thread and it's a number 20. And I started using that, and this is really, really strong stuff. And I've only been using a single thread of this, and it works really well. So let me show you how I do the knots. And as I say, it's the same regardless of whether you save them all and do them at the end, or if you do them as you go along. The reason I left them all to do at the end originally was because it was easier to tighten up the knots if somebody else was helping me. But I've actually found a way that I can do them without needing an extra pair of hands. So let me show you. I'm going to put this one to one side now. And as you can see, this is the one I'm working on. This, because it's paper clipped open, is the one that I've just stitched my thread through. And if I flip it over, you can see here that I have my two pieces of thread coming through from the other side. And as you can see, it's still attached to my needle. So what you do need to do is make sure that you have a good length of thread and just clip that off. Now, you can use, I'm going to be using this needle to help me thread my, tie my knot. You can leave it attached to your thread like I have here and just put it to one side, or you can use a completely new needle. So what I'm going to do now is this comes through from the other side, and if I just tugged one of these ends, it would just pull straight out. So what I'm going to do now is I'm just going to start off my knots, so left over right. I'm just making sure with my finger that I'm just pulling up gently to make sure it's taut, and I'm tightening that thread up. Now, at the moment, it's lying straight down the center of my crease, and the tension is as I would want it to be if I had a knot there. Now, all I'm going to do is turn it so that my thread is 90 degrees to my crease, and I'm just going to anchor it down with a finger on either side, like so. Then I take my needle and I'm just going to put it across where the two threads join. So I'm just putting it across there like so. I can let go of that now because my needle is holding everything in place. So now what I want to do is I want to do the other half of my knot. So the way I do that is I take these two threads, making sure my finger is pressing down hard on the needle. And whilst it's pressing down on the needle, that tension is not going to move. The tension on the thread underneath is not going to move. Now, all I'm doing here, here's my two ends. I'm just crossing them over like so. And then I'm pinching them between my thumb and index finger. Let me do that. And then I'm just rotating so that one of the ends comes through. Now, let me show you that again. There's my cross threads. I'm pinching with my index finger and my thumb where they cross. And then if you rotate, then one of the threads comes through that loop, which is exactly what you want. Now what I'm doing is I'm trapping this thread here, this one here, between my index finger and my middle finger. And I'm getting hold of the other thread and I'm just tightening up that loop. And again, I'm just tightening it up. Can you see that that's what I'm doing? And because I'm holding the thread with that hand, it's tightening up nicely. And the loop now has gone down towards the needle. And this finger is still holding the tension on that needle and my thread underneath, which is exactly what I want. Now, you could leave it like that, but what I find I like to do is hanging on to this thread, I'm changing over my pressure on the needle to the other finger. So I've changed it over to this hand, but I'm still keeping that pressure on that needle and therefore the pressure on the thread underneath. And I can tighten up that knot nice and tight. And then when it is tight, put my finger on that knot above the needle and just take my needle out. Take hold of this side and just pull. And there's my knot. It's all in place. It's nice and tight. And then all I do is snip the end opposite the hole on this side. And similarly on the other side. And if I flip it over, it's nice and tight. Take my paper clips out, put one in, and go on to the next one. Okay, so I hope that was clear enough and you can see everybody. If you can't do it that way, then what you might find you need to do is get somebody to give you a helping hand, so that when you have your threads on this side, they can put their finger on the knot for you, or put the needle on the knot for you to hold it, and then you can tie it tight. But by doing it this way, you tend to find that the threads will automatically lie the right way, and you get them all nicely aligned as you go along. Okay, so I hope that was easy enough to follow. Okay, just very quickly, I'll do that one more time for you. So here's my thread going through to the cover. I'm flipping it over. I've got nice long tails here on this side. Trim it off. Just going to get these threads out of the way. So do the first part of my knot. Left over right, just make sure the tension is nice and tight there and just tighten that up and turn the threads at 90 degrees to the crease. I'm sandwiching the thread on either side between my two fingers, putting my needle down, taking my two tails, crossing them over, index finger and thumb, and rotate to get that thread through the loop, just taking up the slack and pulling, closing that loop down towards the needle. And then now I'm changing over from one finger, one hand to the other. So my knot is nice and tight with the needle sandwiched in the middle of it. So I'm now going to take my needle out and I'm just going to tighten up the knot. Clip away my loose ends. Oopsie-daisy. There we go, clip my loose ends. Flip it over. And clip it. Ready for moving on to the next one. And obviously when you have all your ends knotted and secure on the back, then the only thing left to do is to just take off all your paper clips. Like so. And then just fold up your concertina book or your accordion fold book. And your pre-creased folds will automatically fall into place for you. And there we have it. So there's our little concertina book or accordion fold book. And there we go. So as I said before, you can join the ends together if you want. This one obviously is a little bit stiff at the moment. It's not as pliable as this little one is. But that's only because this one's been played with quite a bit. With this one, it will soften up. And there we go. Our two little accordion fold books. So I hope you're going to give this a go. It's not a difficult project by any means, and they're very cute little things to play with. So thank you so much for watching, as always, everybody, and I hope you enjoyed watching how these were made. Take care now. Bye bye.